one of the most popular Agile frameworks in use today. And rightly so, because it is widely adopted by software and non-software development teams alike. If you want to master Scrum, you need an end-to-end understanding of this framework. Hey guys, this is Archana from Edureka, and I welcome you all to this tutorial on Scrum. This comprehensive Agile Scrum tutorial is designed to help you dive deeper into several aspects of Scrum. Let's get started then. But before we actually begin, let's quickly go through today's agenda. So guys, we will begin this session with a brief introduction to what Agile is. Then we will get started with our today's topic, which is Scrum Framework. We will learn a lot of things about Scrum. We will learn uses of Scrum, Scrum theories, about Scrum values, the three important things in Scrum, which is Scrum Team, Scrum Events, and Scrum Artifacts. After that, we will also learn how entire Scrum sprint process works. And then we will end this session by discussing some success stories of Scrum Framework. So I hope agenda was clear to you guys. Let's get started then. Today, as you guys know, Agile is a well-known development concept and the approach of choice for many development teams, especially those trying to create an environment of continuous delivery. But before Agile came about, development teams, especially those in software, manufacturing, aerospace, and defense industries, would identify problems and plan a solution. They would then work to develop that solution and bring it to the market. Specifically, most teams used waterfall approach, a development methodology in which next phase could begin only after finishing the previous phase. For example, set of steps that would depict waterfall model are: you set project requirements and the scope of work. Next, you design a product based on those set requirements. Then build the product, test the product, fix any problems which were discovered during testing phase, and then launch the finished product to the market. So basically, you start the next step after you're completely done with the previous step. This approach may sound fine, but waterfall model had a lot of disadvantages. It involved a lot of risk and uncertainty. Teams had to stick to requirements and scope of work set out at the very beginning of the project and not make any changes or additions along the way. This model, so, is basically not suitable for randomly changing environment. And following that fixed plan could prove troublesome because it could have taken years before teams actually finished the project at hand. So frustrated by all this, several software development teams began to change their approach to planning and delivering new products throughout the 1990s, which turned into Agile mindset, which we practice today. So it all started in spring of 2000, when a group of 17 software developers met in Oregon to discuss how they could speed up development times in order to bring new software to market at faster rate. They recognized two key opportunities that achieving this goal would make possible, which are shortening the delay of benefits to users in order to resolve the product market fit, getting feedback from users quickly to confirm the usefulness of new software, and continue to improve accordingly. While this meeting did not result in Agile methodology we know today, it was a critical milestone in history of Agile. So less than a year after that Oregon meeting, the history of Agile came into focus when same group of 17 developers met again, this time at a ski resort in Snowbird, Utah. Within 3 days, the group produced the Manifesto for Agile Software Development, today which we usually refer to as Agile Manifesto. I'm sure you might have heard of it. So a turning point in history of Agile, this manifesto laid out four key values. Those four key values are: individuals and interactions over process and tools, working software over comprehensive documentation, customer collaboration over contract negotiation, and the last one is responding to change over following a plan. These values represent a significant breakthrough in the history of Agile. But the group did not stop there. To give even more color to their vision, they also laid out 12 principles that stand behind these values. For example, you have customer satisfaction, welcome change, frequent delivery, constant pace, good design, working software after every increment, simplicity, and many more. These four values and 12 principles continue to guide the Agile methodology used by teams even today. So what exactly is Agile? Is it a methodology? Is it a framework? No. Agile is a philosophy, a way of thinking, a movement, really one that helps us deliver products and services more quickly. So basically, it is a set of ideas for actions that keep a software development team organized and efficient. So when people talk about an agile product development, what they're usually describing is a flexible, iterative design and build process. Agile projects are characterized by a series of tasks that are conceived, executed, and adapted as situation demands rather than a pre-planned process. So being agile helps teams respond to unpredictability through incremental, iterative work process. So in simple terms, it's a combination of iterative and incremental process models with focus on process adaptability and customer satisfaction by rapid delivery of working software product at every increment. So this agile way of developing products has a lot of advantages. I'm sure by now you might have guessed few, right? For example, it offers early value delivery. So if you have any changes during the process, you can easily adapt them. That's what agile is all about. Better customer experience because at every step you take feedback from the customer. You offer scope control, lower risk factors because agile is all about checking and adaption, or you can say inspection and adaption. So the amount of risk you face is very low when compared to traditional development models. There's also a lot of collaboration and communication between team members, which is really a good thing because it will provide success in long term. Then there is this enhanced quality, the main important advantage. Because of this teamwork, low risk and better customer experience and all that, your product is of high quality when you use agile philosophy. And lastly, it offers high sustainability. So using agile development philosophy, or you can say mindset, offers a lot of advantages. Going back to previous slide, agile comes in number of forms, meaning there are number of subsets to agile project development. We usually refer to this as agile umbrella. So each one of these emphasis a somewhat different approach within the confines of incremental, iterative and adaptive philosophy of agile. And one of the subset is Scrum. It's the most popular, simple and flexible agile framework. So think of agile like a water. We have hot, cold and warm water, right? Different types. So water has some characteristics. Cold is one of its features. Hot is another one. So likewise, Scrum is one of agile process. Scrum is not only one of the greatest inventions in agile, but also one of the most popular frameworks. The term Scrum was first introduced by professors Hirotaka and Nonaka in their 1986 Harvard Business Review article, where they described Scrum as a rugby-styled approach to product development. One where a team moves forward while passing a ball back and forth. I'm sure you might have heard of the game, right? Rugby game. So they compared the Scrum with a rugby game. In the following years, the software developers like Ken and Jeff each implemented Hirotaka and Nonaka-inspired development strategies at their own respective companies. And in 1995, the two came together to present and define their own version of Scrum, a development strategy that evolved into Scrum framework, which we use today. So what exactly is the Scrum framework which we use today? Scrum is a lightweight agile project management framework that can be used to manage complex iterative and incremental projects of all types. You can think of it as a collection of roles, events, artifacts, and the rules used in combination to create iterative work products. The concept basically here is to break large complex projects into smaller stages, reviewing and adopting along the way. So one thing, guys, very often Scrum is found to be identified as a methodology, but it is usually recommended to think of it as a framework for managing complex processes. Moving further, Scrum has three unique characteristics that have made it popular. These are the separating variables that set Scrum apart from rest of the Agile frameworks. So what are they? Scrum is lightweight, simple to understand, difficult to master. So what do I mean when I say lightweight? It comprises of rules and practices that are few in number and which are easy to follow. So that's why the word lightweight. Simplicity. One unique identity of Scrum is that it is simple to understand. This makes framework easy to comprehend even for the beginners. And lastly, it's difficult to master. So there's a big difference between understanding Scrum and implementing it in real-time projects. While it's easy to understand, while implementing it might be quite difficult if you're not thorough with the topics. So you need to practice in real time and learn the concepts in depth. So guys, moving further, on screen you can see an image depicting entire Scrum framework. I'm sure all the concepts or the words that you see are unfamiliar with, right? For example, there's something called product backlog, sprint planning, and there's sprint and potentially shippable increment. You might be thinking what all these terms are. Well, don't worry, this session is all about covering those concepts, right? So let's begin with the basics first. So guys, with Scrum, you write fewer plans and do more in short iterations or cycles that we call sprints. You don't work on separate groups, but you work as one dedicated and committed team. Instead of working on a project with distant deadline, you constantly deliver functioning products, which we call increments. You don't use final evaluation. Instead, you receive continuous feedback from your customers and improvise your product based on those feedbacks. That's what Scrum is all about. So in simple terms, it is a flexible way of working in rapidly changing world. Moving on, most often people use the term Agile and Scrum interchangeably, which is a wrong thing to do. There are two different things. While Agile is a broad term, Scrum is just a part of it. A good analogy to compare Scrum and Agile would be the difference between a recipe and a diet. A diet is a set of methods and practices based on the principles and values. A recipe would be a framework you can use to implement your diet. Do you understand the difference? So, in this context, Agile is diet, and Scrum is the recipe that you follow. To put it in technical terms, Agile is a mindset focusing on communication, team thinking, intrinsic motivation, empowerment, many other keywords while developing a product. Whereas Scrum is a framework that implements Agile philosophies, rules, values, and principles. Simple enough, right? So Agile and Scrum are not the same after all. They both come from similar places but are solving different things. Talking more about Scrum, Scrum was initially developed for managing and developing products. Starting in early 1990s, Scrum has been used extensively worldwide for multiple purposes. It is used for research and identify markets, new technologies and product potentials, develop product and product enhancements, release product and product enhancement very frequently, like in one in every day. Develop and sustain cloud environments and other kind of operational environments for use. Sustain and renew products and many other things. So fairly early on, Scrum found widespread adoption in diverse domains. It was used in developing software, embedded systems, hardware, schools, automation, autonomous vehicles, government, interacting with network functions, and I can just keep going. The lot of applications which use Scrum. So with steady rise in technology, market, and environmental complexities, Scrum has proved its use in almost every sphere. Scrum is now broadly used for all the services, products, and in managing the organizations. And now that you know how popular Scrum is and where it is used, let's check out what Scrum is actually based on. Scrum is founded based on empirical process control theory or empirism. Empirical process control is core Scrum principle and distinguishes it from other agile frameworks. So this empirical process control basically relies on three main ideas, which are transparency, inspection, and adaption. Simple enough, right? They're straightforward terms. But anyway, let me explain how these terms apply in Scrum framework. So transparency. Transparency allows all facets of any Scrum process to be observed by everyone in the team. This promotes an easy and transparent flow of information throughout the organization, and it creates an open work culture. So in Scrum, transparency is depicted through artifacts, regular meetings, information radiators like burn down charts, Scrum board, and many other things. Well, we will learn about all these terms later on in the session, so don't worry about them for now. Moving on, inspection. Those who work on Scrum must need to regularly inspect the Scrum artifacts and progress towards the sprint goal to detect some variations in the timeline. So this inspection should be done regularly, so it does not disrupt the productive work time of the team. Inspection in Scrum is usually depicted through use of a common Scrum board or other information radiators, collection of continuous feedback from the customer and other stakeholders during the development cycle, and all that. So first of all, every work that's done in the team is visible to everyone. That's transparency. Then you have inspection. All the work that's done is tested so that the time is not wasted. Lastly, you have adaption. Adaption happens as the Scrum team and stakeholders learn through transparency and inspection, and then adapt by making improvements in the work along the way. And this adaption is usually depicted through stand-up meetings, constant risk evaluation, or Scrum guidance body, or some retrospective meetings, or project meetings, and all that. And the entire Scrum is based on these three principles: transparency, inspection, and adaption. With empirical process control, you don't fix the scope of the product nor the process of how to build it. Instead, you create a small shippable piece of product in short cycles. Inspect what and how you created it, and adapt the product and the way you built it with built-in mechanisms for transparency to enable clear inspection. In addition to this, Scrum added 5 values to framework that each member of team uses to guide his decision making. 5 values that are foundation for a Scrum team's process and interaction are courage, focus, commitment, respect, and openness. Let's begin by understanding each of these and how they apply to Scrum team. First comes courage. The Scrum team members have the courage to do right thing and work on tough problems. The team members support each other in doing the right thing and in taking informed risks so that they can learn and improve along their path to destination or reaching their goal. So that's what courage is all about. Then comes respect. As self-organizing teams, Scrum teams can't be successful without respect for each other. With respect, they will cultivate an engaged, productive, and humane environment for all. So the Scrum framework includes elements that help promote respect. For example, the entire Scrum team attends sprint planning, sprint preview, and retrospective. You will know what they are. This promotes respect for each role, the accountabilities, and the diverse perspectives. So basically, every member should respect every other member and their responsibilities. Next, you have openness. While it's nothing but transparency, every team member should know what the team is actually working on and what their part is in contributing to achieve the goal. Next up, we have commitment. Scrum team members must be committed to success, and they must be willing to create realistic goals and stick to them. Every Scrum role should commit to the success of the team, not just caring about their individual achievements. So individual commitment as well as entire team commitment, both are important here. And this creates an environment of trust, productive problem solving, and high team standards. Next up, we have focus. Everyone in the Scrum team must focus on the work of the sprint and the goal of the team. Since they deal with complexity and unpredictability, focus is really essential in order to get anything meaningful done in a proper amount of time. They should also focus on keeping the customer happy by being focused on the sprint and its goal. So the moment anyone enters into organization which is using Scrum, they should and must understand these Scrum values for them to successfully be part of the team. Well, not a lot of people know and understand these values, but they are critical to the successful implementation of Scrum in any organization. Well, that being said, you don't understand Scrum until you know the people and the parts of Scrum. The Scrum framework is made up of 3 distinct categories: roles, events, and artifacts. Let's break this down. So first of all, we have roles or people involved. The Scrum framework is defined by three core roles, which are product owner, Scrum Master, and the development team. Let's check out who they are and what their responsibilities are in Scrum team. So first up, we have product owner. The product owner is accountable for the work the team is supposed to complete, whether they do it by themselves or give it to other team members, whatever. So product owner not only focuses on the work to be completed, but he also manages business and market requirements. The main role of product owner is to motivate the team to align them with the goal and the vision of the project. So remember that product owner is always a single person and not a committee. That being said, they can take help from the other team members when they're developing a product and all that. But when it comes to making major decisions, he alone is responsible. That is, product owner alone will be responsible for the results of the decisions he make. So now that you have a basic idea of who a product owner is, let's check out few important roles of a product owner, what a product owner actually does. First of all, he manages and orders the item and product backlog in order to achieve the best goals and machines. Ignore the term product backlog for now. Basically, product backlog is nothing but it is a list of requirements of the product. Next up, a product owner progresses the value of work done by the development team. He makes sure that the product backlog is visible, transparent, and clear to all and defines the upcoming task of a Scrum team. He assures whether the development team understands the items which are printed in the product backlog to the level they're expected to know. So basically, as a product owner, he does all these things. Again, guys, remember that product owner is a single person and not a committee. Now let's discuss responsibilities of product owner, Indy. So first of all, a product owner manages economics. So the product owner is responsible for ensuring that good economic decisions are continuously being made at different levels, say release, sprint, and product backlog levels. Next up, he is responsible for grooming the product backlog, like I said earlier. So the product owner oversees the grooming of the product backlog, which includes creating and refining, estimating, and prioritizing the product backlog items. He might not do it personally, like I said earlier, but he might oversee the entire process though. He also participates in various levels of planning that happen during the entire Scrum process. So the product owner is a key participant in portfolio, product release, and sprint planning activities. During each of these meetings, he has a role to play. Sometimes he guides, sometimes he listens, sometimes he works along with the development team, and so much more. Which brings me to the next topic, which is he collaborates with the development team regularly. So the product owner must closely collaborate with the development team on a frequent basis. He is an engaged, committed, everyday role. So apart from that, he also collaborates with stakeholders. The product owner is a single voice of entire stakeholder community, which includes internal as well as external. Internal stakeholders can include business system owners, you have executive management program, marketing, sales, and many others. Whereas external stakeholders can include customers, end users, partners, regulatory bodies, and many others. So basically, he's one person, or he's the person who voices the opinion of stakeholders, be it internal or external stakeholders. Well, with that said, what are the core qualities of a product owner? Well, we have been discussing a lot about product owner, right? By listening to all that, you might have guessed few qualities. Let's quickly go through what they are. First of all, he must be customer delighted. So a product owner should listen what stakeholders want, discover those latent needs that customer or user hasn't ever imagined. He should be a good storyteller. As a product owner, he should think about what will transform the story into effective product feature that delights the user. And next, he should be a knowledge broker. The product owner, he represents the product backlog and the interface between the team and the stakeholders, which includes both external and internal. Remember that. And lastly, he should be conflict resolver. As a product owner, he should have the courage and the capability to engage when things get really difficult. He should be able to break down the problems and solve them. So basically, having a superior and a good product owner is a boon for any team. He takes care of the project and keeps his head high and walks through each and every challenge help in delivering a high quality product. Next up, we have Scrum Master. Scrum Master is team's resident facilitator. He is responsible for helping all the team members follow Scrum theories, rules, and practices. So the Scrum Master makes sure that entire Scrum team has whatever it needs to complete the work, like they remove roadblocks that are holding up the progress, they organize meetings, they deal with the challenges and the bottlenecks that they might come across, and all that. Before we actually proceed into discussing roles and responsibility of a Scrum Master, let's start by discussing what Scrum Master is not. Because Scrum Master is mostly misunderstood for the roles which he's not supposed to do. For example, Scrum Master is not the person calling everyone for the Scrum meetings, as in he might be responsible for organizing the meeting, but he alone is not responsible. He takes help from Scrum team members or the product owner. So it's not his core responsibility. And Scrum Master is not responsible for all the problems that might arise when you're working on a project. And another most commonly misunderstood concept is that Scrum Master is responsible for talking to stakeholders, which is definitely not the right thing. You can't say Scrum Master is entirely responsible for talking to stakeholders because, like I discussed earlier, the product owner is the voice of entire stakeholder group. And lastly, Scrum Master is not the boss. He or she is just a part of Scrum team like any other person in the team, which involves development team and the product owner. So if something goes wrong when you're actually developing a project using Scrum, Scrum Master alone cannot be held responsible for all the things. The entire development team, Scrum Master, as well as the product owner will be held responsible. So if Scrum Master is none of the above, what does a Scrum Master actually do then? Basically, Scrum Masters are responsible for three groups, which are product owner, development team, and the organization. They serve product owner, development team, and organization in different ways. Let's discuss how. So guys, Scrum Master serves product owner in multiple ways. For example, he helps product owner find effective product backlog management techniques. He helps product owner understand what the term agility means and practice it thoroughly in the organization. He facilitates Scrum events as and when requested by the product owner. He also helps product owner arrange product backlog, make it transparent, clear, and visible to all the people in the Scrum team. He also makes product owner help him understand and make the entire team understand how product planning is in empirical environment. Well, these are just few. A Scrum Master helps product owner in many other multiple ways. Moving on, Scrum Master also helps development team in number of ways. For example, he removes all the obstacles, impediments, and the bottlenecks that might decrease the progress of the team along the way. He helps team create high value products by listening to their difficulties and solving them. He also facilitates Scrum events, which are requested by development team as and when required during the sprint execution. He also coaches the entire development team when the Scrum is initially developed by the entire organization. So what happens is when Scrum is initially adopted by organization, no one is actually familiar with the concepts of Scrum. So Scrum Master makes sure that everyone in the development team understand what Scrum is about, its values and principles. Moving on, Scrum Master also helps organization as a whole in multiple ways. First of all, he helps employees and stakeholders understand and implement Scrum practices. He also leads and coaches entire organization on Scrum adoption on how to do it. He causes changes that increase the productivity of Scrum team and increase their performance. And also, the important thing is that he works with other Scrum Masters to increase the effectiveness of the team and the quality of the product. So this way, he helps product owner, development team, as well as entire organization. So to sum up responsibilities of a Scrum Master, first of all is a coach. Scrum Master is a coach for both development team and the product owner. He can remove barriers between the roles and enable the product owner to directly drive the development. He focuses on the team and finds a way to help the team to make it to their sprint goal. Next, he is a servant leader. So often Scrum Master is called a servant leader. Though he coaches the team, He is a servant to the Scrum team. As a servant leader, he should have listening skills, empathy, cultivating a culture of trust, acting with humility, encouraging others to do their work, and all that. So basically, he is a team leader as well as a servant. And that's how the term servant leader matches the Scrum Master. So next up is process authority. That's nothing but, like I keep saying, he's responsible to make sure that entire team understands what Scrum is. And once they do, they stick to what Scrum is, not deviating from the Scrum values, roles, events, and philosophies and all that. Next up, he's an impediment remover. Scrum Master holds responsibility for removing impediments, mainly the project blockheads that impede the process or decrease the progress of the process and all that. He also acts as an interference shield. Scrum Master acts as a protector. He helps the team by protecting it from outside interference that results in delivering the business value every sprint. So these are the key responsibilities of a Scrum Master. Next up, we have qualities of a Scrum Master. After discussing so much about roles and responsibilities, I'm sure you could point out some qualities of a Scrum Master, right? First of all, like I said, he's a servant leader. So basically, we have two terms there. He guides and he should be observant, which is the key feature of being a servant leader. He should be influential enough because though product owner is responsible to talking stakeholders, sometimes Scrum Master has to talk to stakeholders as well and make them understand the adoption of Scrum is really important for an organization. Important thing is he should be transparent, as in his goals and his way of doing things should be visible and honest and ethical to the entire team. That's what we call transparent. Collaborative, as in he should interact with both product owner and the development team to develop the project and lead them to the success. And he should be patient, obviously, and knowledgeable. He should have enough knowledge on Scrum practices, theories, agile and all that so that he'll be able to lead the team. So in simple terms, Scrum Master plays a pivotal role in balancing the interest of the other two Scrum roles, which is product owner and the development team. Okay, now we know about product owner and Scrum Master. So next up, we have development team. It's quite simple. So the development team is exactly what it sounds like, the people working together to deliver products. Well, there is no such fixed size of Scrum development team. It may vary from one Scrum team to another Scrum team. Ideally, a development team should be small enough to remain agile and large enough to complete a significant amount of work within assigned time. This will result in a product of best possible value and quality. And talking about different characteristics of a development team. So first of all, they are self-organizing teams, as in no one actually guides the development team on how to convert the product backlog into increments and all that. Development teams are generally cross-functional, while it comprises of members with varied skills. So as a team, these combined skill sets are necessary to create a successful product. Development team members do not have any individual titles. Each member is identified only as part of team, irrespective of the work they do. Scrum recognizes no subteams in development teams. It's a development team. There are no subteams. That's it. So what are their core responsibilities? So first of all, they perform sprint execution. They interact with the rest of the team members and the product owner as well as Scrum Master and develop the product according to the requirements. They inspect and adapt, as in they take feedback from the customer or stakeholders, and based on the feedback they receive, they adapt and improve the product. They groom the product backlog. Well, the product owner is responsible for managing the product backlog, but development team helps as well. They plan the entire sprint, as in they decide what should be done during the sprint and how can they achieve the sprint goal. Talking about the qualities of product owner, like I said, teamwork is really important. So everyone in the development team should be a team player. They should have the self-motivation so that they contribute to their goal as well as team goal. They should be knowledgeable enough to work in the team, obviously. And pair programming. That's again, they should be able to work properly when assigned to them. And that too in proper groups. So guys, we are done with the first part of Scrum Framework, which is Scrum Roles. Next up, we have something called Scrum Events. In particular, there are about 4 events that you will encounter during the Scrum process. But before we proceed any further, you should be aware of what a sprint is, or you can say a Scrum sprint is. So a sprint basically is a specified time period during which a Scrum team produces a product. That's all sprint is all about. And the concept of using the sprint really helps a lot, and it has a lot of advantages, and it helps in developing a good quality product in reasonable amount of time. So the first thing about sprint is it's time boxed. So from the concept of time boxing, the sprints are fixed with a characteristic of time management approach that helps the entire team to manage the scope and organize the work performance. And this time box is also a technique which helps to keep the limit of work in progress. And since the entire work needs to be completed in a specific period of time, it forces prioritization. The team has to decide on which task is important and which needs to be done first in the sprint. It also demonstrates progress of the team, avoid unnecessary perfections. It motivates closure, as in it motivates to complete the sprint within a fixed time and that too within short duration. It improves the predictability. It makes planning much easier. And lastly, it also offers high return of investment and all that. So that's all sprint is about. To tell you again, sprint basically is a specific time period during which a Scrum team produces a product. Now let's go ahead and try to understand each of the four events which I mentioned earlier. First up, we have something called sprint planning. So sprint planning is a meeting where the work to be done during a sprint is mapped out by the team members. During this meeting, the entire team clearly defines deliverables of the sprint and designs the work necessary to achieve that goal. So it is an event where you can get answers to the following questions, which are: what can be delivered in this sprint iteration and how to achieve that work? Let me elaborate. So what can be delivered in the sprint iteration? So the development team decides on the functionalities to be worked upon during the sprint duration. The product owner modifies the product backlog accordingly and discusses the project target that they should achieve in that particular sprint. Entire Scrum team takes part in sprint planning to understand the work or the task to be performed in that sprint, and they create a sprint goal. What do they create? A sprint goal. Next up, how will the work needed to deliver be achieved? So once the entire team agrees on the product backlog items and they set the sprint goal, they start developing the functionality. They do so by designing the system and the work needed to convert the product backlog into the increment. So basically, by end of product planning or the sprint planning, the development team should be able to explain how it is going to accomplish the sprint goal which they have set up. Next up, we have something called daily scrum. So this daily scrum is time box approach, which is particularly for about 15 minutes or around. It usually takes place at the same time in the same place and which is attended by development team, which is mandatory. But Scrum Master has a choice of attending or not attending it. So it's facilitated by Scrum Master, but development team need to be present compulsorily. And the entire meeting is basically focused on three questions, which are: what was done yesterday by the development team that helped them meet the sprint goal? What will be done today by the team that will help them meet the sprint goal? Are there any impediments that are preventing the team from meeting the sprint goal and stopping their progress? So basically, these three questions and answers to these questions are discussed in that meeting. And we call that meeting daily scrum. So what's the main purpose of this daily scrum? It increases the development team skills. It ensures transparency, as in everyone knows what's happening in the team, what they have to do. It creates alignment and highlight the problems that are needed to be resolved immediately. It increases team performance and promotes quick decision making. Well, that's all. Next up, we have sprint review. I think the name itself gives you an idea of what it is, right? Sprint review meeting. During the sprint review, product owner explains what the planned work was and what was not completed during that particular sprint. The entire team then presents completed work and they discuss what went well and how problems were solved. Here are some important points which are related to sprint review. Well, first of all, sprint review meeting is held at the end of each sprint. It is usually attended by stakeholders, which involves external as well as internal stakeholders that we discussed earlier, the Scrum team and others. So what's the input to this entire sprint review meeting? Sprint goal, sprint backlog, and the shippable product. Because it happens at the end of every sprint, you have a product increment or shippable product. So these are the inputs. So all the people who attend the meeting inspect the product and they give their feedback, and based on that, they make the improvements. Well, this does not have a fixed time frame. It usually lasts for about 4 hours for 1 month sprint, or it can be shorter for shorter sprints. So basically, the Scrum team and the stakeholders who attend the meeting collaborate and plan for the next sprint goal, and they discuss what were the improvements that they made in the sprint. The team does research on marketplaces and they estimate the budget, potential capabilities, timeline, and marketplaces for upcoming release and all that features. Thus, keeping all these factors in mind, a revised product backlog is basically the result at the end of every sprint review meeting. Sprint goals, sprint backlog, and an increment or shippable product is the input. The stakeholders, Scrum team, and others who attend the meeting discuss about budget, capabilities, and what went wrong, what they improved, improvements, and all that. So they inspect and adapt. And finally, what you get is a revised product backlog as the output. That's all about sprint review meeting. And lastly, what we have is sprint retrospective. So during sprint retrospective, the team discusses what went right, what went wrong, and how to improve. They decide on how to fix the problems and create a plan for improvement to be enacted during the next sprint. Regardless of how good a Scrum team is, there's always room for improvement, right? So a good Scrum team will always focus on continuous improvement opportunities, which is usually discussed in this retrospective meeting. So that's what happens in retrospective meeting. They discuss what went wrong, what went right, and what are the improvements that they need to make. So this brings us to the end of discussion on Scrum events. Next up, we have Scrum artifacts. Well, artifacts are just physical records that provide project details when developing a product. Scrum artifacts provide the key information to Scrum team members and the stakeholders regarding how product is developed, and they also provide information on activities which are to be done and what activities are being planned in the project. So the important Scrum artifacts include product backlog, sprint backlog, burn down charts, and product increments. Usually, burn down charts are not listed as artifacts. They are listed as additional artifacts. So the three important artifacts are product backlog, sprint backlog, and product increment. Let's discuss each of them. So product backlog, well, it is a simple document that outlines the list of tasks and every requirement that the final product actually needs. It's constantly evolving and it's never complete. The product owner manages the product backlog, including how it's made available to the entire Scrum team, its content, and how it's ordered, and everything. The product owner and the rest of the team, they work together to review the product backlog and make the adjustment as and when necessary. So for each item which is listed down in the product backlog, you should add some additional information like the description of the item, the priority, the estimated amount of time, the value it adds to the business when executed, and all that. So in simple terms, it's a document or an ordered list of tasks and requirements that the final product needs. Moving on, we have sprint backlog. In simple terms, sprint backlog is a subset of product backlog. Basically, it's a list of items and things that you need when you are working on a sprint. So when it comes to sprint backlog, you have different things that need to be done during the sprint, right? In that case, team members actually sign up for the task based on their skills and the priorities. It's a real-time picture of work that the team currently plans to complete during that particular sprint. Now, talking about some important features of sprint backlog, well, it's dynamic in nature. It keeps changing according to the requirements of the sprint. It's an outcome of sprint planning meetings like we discussed earlier. It is owned by the development team. So for every sprint, the team members create a document based on the requirements and the market value priority, which we call a sprint backlog. Lastly, we have product increment. The most important artifact is product increment, or in other words, the sum of product work completed during a sprint combined with all work completed during previous sprint. Important point is that increment must be in usable condition regardless of if the product owner decides to release it to market or not. So basically, the product or the part of the product which you get after every sprint should be a working product. So basically, a product increment is a forward step towards a goal or a vision of the Scrum team. Apart from the three artifacts which we discussed just now, which is product backlog, sprint backlog, and product increment, we have other artifacts as well, like we have burn down charts and burn up charts. So burn down charts and burn up charts are used to trace the progress of the project. The burn up chart basically illustrates the amount of work completed, while the burn down chart illustrates the amount of work which is remained or which is still there to complete a project. Remember that the efforts here are measured in terms of user stories, but not in time like hours, minutes, and all that. Well, with this, we have covered almost all the basic key terms associated with Scrum framework. If you are confused with all these terms, well, don't worry. The Scrum jargon easily becomes second nature once you're using it, and at least when you come across a practical example of Scrum framework implementation. So to make it more easier for you guys, I have an example of how Scrum is implemented. Let's discuss it. So the entire Scrum process starts with a product owner. Like we discussed earlier, product owner is a person who represents the stakeholders' best interest and has the authority to say what goes on into the final product. So next, the product owner creates a product backlog, which is a list of tasks and requirements the final product actually needs. Important point is that the backlog must be prioritized. So that's the job of product owner. If I were using Scrum to design a car, items like must have an engine would be first in my list, because car wouldn't run without engine, right? But requirement like must be painted red can come last in the product backlog list, because my car can run and I can go anywhere without my car being painted. So that's not of a much priority. So now the entire team, which is product owner, the Scrum team and the development team and the Scrum master, get together for the sprint planning, which is when the team decides together what to work on first from that product backlog. A sprint, like we discussed, is a predefined amount of time within which the entire team creates a working piece of product. So at the beginning of the sprint, the developers and the product owner agrees on the items from the backlog, which they will complete during the sprint. This subset of items from the product backlog becomes the sprint backlog, like we discussed earlier. So the Scrum team just isn't pushing forward with blinders on, because they get together every day to communicate progress and issues. This meeting is what we call daily Scrum, or in other words, a stand-up meeting, and is overseen by Scrum Master, whose job is to keep everyone on efficient path. So during these daily meetings, like we discussed, each development team member expresses what task has been accomplished, what they should do, and if they are facing any impediments or any obstacles that are hindering their progress and all that. So Scrum Master, who is like the coach on the field with the Scrum team, removes the distractions, removes the bottlenecks and all the impediments and obstacles that the team might be facing. At the end of the sprint period, the team should have a functional piece of something to show their work, which is what we call a product increment. The important thing is that the product, or the piece of the product which is a result of a sprint, should be working. So at the end of the sprint, a sprint review meeting is organized for the product owner. All the stakeholders, like the external as well as the internal stakeholders and the Scrum team, attends the sprint review meeting. During the meeting, they demonstrate what they have completed since the last sprint. The product owner gives information about what is remaining on the product backlog and the amount of time, or the estimated time, which might be required to complete the project if needed. After the sprint review meeting, the development team gathers up in sprint retrospective meeting, during which they discusses what they have done good, what went wrong, and what improvements they can make so that they can adapt and make changes in the next sprint. For example, maybe it's a tech limitation holding them back, or maybe one team member is overloaded with tasks. So whatever, the team decides on how to fix these problems with the intent of improving their efficiency next sprint. So this entire cycle, starting with the sprint planning and ending with the sprint retrospective, goes on until either the deadline has been reached, or the budget is exhausted, or the product owner is satisfied with the final product, whichever comes first. So in a nutshell, that's how a Scrum process works. So it starts with sprint planning and ends with sprint retrospective, and it goes on until, like I said, the product has been completed, or the budget is exhausted, or the deadline has been reached, whichever comes first. So I hope the concept is clear. Apart from what we discussed today, there are certain other concepts of Scrum that you might come across. For example, there's something called Scrum of Scrums. What do you think it is? For example, let's say there's an active project with about 7 teams working on it. The number of members of each team is also 7, and they're all responsible to read their own Scrum meeting. But in order to coordinate and communicate with different Scrum teams, they need to organize a separate Scrum meeting, and that is what we call Scrum of Scrums. The responsible person from each Scrum team attends the meeting, discuss their work and progress. Next up, we have something called storyboard. An important principle in Scrum is the idea of transparency. So all team members involved should be aware of what everyone else is working on, the progress that's being made, and what the team is trying to accomplish. And that's why making things visible for all of them to see is really important. So a big part of this is Scrum Board. Scrum Board is a place where you can organize your backlog as well as tasks that are being worked on and the tasks that you need to work on. So basically, it has 4 columns: the to-do list, the progress, the testing, and the done column. So basically, the Scrum Boards can be as simple as a whiteboard with sticky notes for each task, or it can be like a specialized software with charts and task tracking features and all that. It depends on your taste. Lastly, we also have some popular Agile certifications. In interviews, interviewee often asks for certifications. This sort of question might seem awkward if you do not have any certification. Well, in such cases, just stay calm and just let the interviewer know if you're planning to take any in future. If yes, then mention why you're planning to take that particular certification and all the other details. For your reference, here are some certifications which are generally looked for when you are attending Scrum job interviews. We have Agile Certified Practitioner. You have Agile Scrum Master, Certified Scrum Master, Professional Scrum Master, and Safe Agilist. Apart from this, they might ask you if you are a Certified Scrum Master. So don't panic if you don't have any certification and they ask you this question. Just be confident and answer if you have a Scrum Master certification or not. If you are a Certified Scrum Master, just share the details of your certification, like the type, score obtained, the year of passing, and other details. In case you're not certified, do highlight your experience in that particular field and let the interviewer know if you're planning to take one in future. If so, why that particular certification? Well, that's it. Well, I'm sure by end of this, you are aware of all the important concepts which you might come across if you're working in a Scrum team or as a part of a Scrum team. So guys, with this, we have come almost to the end of the session. I'm sure this tutorial has covered a lot of basic topics that you might come across when you're working in a Scrum team or if you're trying to master a Scrum framework. But like I have been saying, learning the concepts and the terms involved in Scrum is really easy. But actually implementing the Scrum framework in an organization or for the practical purpose is quite difficult, which is basically said in the definition of the Scrum as well. But do not worry, you will get used to it as long as you're working in a team and understanding all the concepts and all that. So Scrum has become really popular, and there are a lot of organizations who have adopted Scrum and have successfully delivered best quality products to the market. Now let's take a look at some success stories of Scrum framework. So best way to understand Scrum is to learn from the Scrum case studies if you're not working as a part of team. Here are some popular case studies that can help you master Scrum framework. First of all, I have a BBC Scrum case study. I'm sure you might have heard about British Broadcasting Corporation, right? So head of development, Andrew Scotland for the BBC's new media division, who is a certified Scrum Master, introduced Scrum practice into the new media division's multidisciplinary development teams, like software engineering teams, user experience teams, information architecture teams, editorial teams, product management teams, project management teams, and many other teams. So basically, as a Scrum Master, he introduced this Scrum framework into all these multidisciplinary developing teams. Adoption of Scrum helped the BBC's new media division deliver effective software when the user requirements were ever-changing. In an interview, Andrew Scotland also said that it took the company a bit of time to adjust or to adapt the Scrum, but it was well worth and brought about significant differences. Next up, we have Dutch Railways. Dutch Railways are among the most heavily used in the world, providing transport for about 1.2 million passengers daily. Dutch Railways built a new information system to provide travelers with more accurate travel information, requiring less manual intervention. So the first attempt to build this pub system or public system was executed using a traditional waterfall approach. But after 3 years, the project was cancelled because the vendor failed to deliver a working system. Because of this, they adopted Scrum, which worked magic with highly distributed teams in the Dutch Railway team. It allowed them to deliver tested software at the end of each sprint without regression bugs, and the return of investment also outweighed the cost or the amount they spent. Wonderful, right? Moving on to our next example, we have Vodafone Turkey. Incorporated by Vodafone Group, Vodafone Turkey was founded in 2006. That is Turkey's second largest mobile communication company since 2014. It provides service to about 20.4 million subscribers. They adopted Scrum, and that helped them in many ways. For example, establishment of Scrum teams have triggered changes at organizational structure and processes to the team-focused way. So transparency within the team also led to achievement of success and many other things. So these are some most popular success stories of Scrum, how organizations adopted Scrum after their failure and then succeeded by adopting Scrum and all that. So apart from these, there are other organizations that have adopted Scrum as well and achieved success. Well, with this, we have come to the end of the tutorial. I hope you've understood the most basic concepts of Scrum that you might come across. Well, if you have any doubts or queries regarding this tutorial or any concept that was discussed in this tutorial, please do post them in the comment section below and we will get back to you as soon as possible. And if you have liked the tutorial, please do not forget to click the like button. Thank you guys, and I'll meet you in next session with another interesting topic.
I hope you have enjoyed listening to this video. Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries, and we will reply them at the earliest. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to Edureka channel to learn more. Happy learning!